What is currently happening, programs? Today, I'm going to cover everything we know about Oculus Quest, a wireless VR headset that has a lot of people excited and for the right reasons. So if you want to know all the specs, what it can do, who it's for, and why this is a big deal, then stay locked, enjoy, and I hope it helps. First up, what is the Oculus Quest? Quest was formerly known as the Santa Cruz prototype and is a completely standalone VR headset. That means no wires, no external sensors, no PC, and no phone is required at all to use this HMD. You put it on, turn it on, and then
get it on!
Get it on. It will come with two touch controllers that have all the same buttons as Rift touch controllers, including the thumbsticks, which not only means familiarity for existing Rift owners, but reduced programming times for developers porting existing games from Rift to Quest. It will have best in-class optics and built-in audio, which I'll get into in a minute, and sport Oculus's Insight tracking system, which consists of a handful of technologies such as 6 degrees of freedom, ultra wide angle, self-contained markerless, inside out arena scale tracking, courtesy of 4 camera sensors on the headset. And it's all these things that allow you to do stuff with Quest that you cannot with any other VR headset. And I'll get into those in a minute too. First, let's break down Insight tracking. 6 degrees of freedom tracking lets you move your position left and right, up and down, and forward and back, as well as turn your head left and right, up and down, and tilt your head left and right. Unlike the Oculus Go's 3 degrees of freedom tracking, which only lets you look left, right, up, down, and tilt your head left and right, but not move your body in physical space and have that tracked in VR. Ultra wide angle tracking keeps an eye on your controllers when you extend them out of your field of view, more so than the limited tracking on what you would see from the Windows WMR headsets, meaning it's more than suitable for games like Robo Recall or Echo Arena, where your hand movements are somewhat magnified. When your hands go outside of that tracking range, the headset guesstimates where your hands have been once they come back into range, almost instantaneously, thus providing you with a believable controller tracked experience. Markerless tracking means that the headset doesn't need any markers in the real world, such as dots or stickers, for the headset to position you accurately in VR. It instead scans your environment in real time and observes the objects around you to gather where you are in your virtual environment. It does have its limitations though, as things like too much or too little light, low contrast, like having the same color furniture, floors and walls, or lots of reflections like mirrors or shiny objects in your real world play space can blow out the tracking. But for everyday VR use cases, Quest tracking works very well. Inside out tracking means that all of the tracking is done on the headset and you don't need external sensors, like you do with Oculus's Constellation or Valve's Lighthouse tracking technologies. And arena scale tracking means that this tracking extends to a theoretically infinite scale. And though that won't be supported in the immediate future, it does mean you could, for instance, go beyond the boundaries of your room scale tracking and walk around in a much larger environment. And in fact, that's what players at Oculus Connect 5 got to do. What you are seeing here is called co-location multiplayer, which is where a load of programs with Oculus Quest headsets are all playing against each other in the same game of Dead and Buried, completely wireless. And yes, the headsets are tracking each other thanks to a master spatial map of the arena that each headset recognizes, accesses, and shares. There's also a proof of concept called asymmetric co-location, which lets a program without a VR headset holding a device like an iPad to tap into that same master spatial map and see what the players are seeing in real time, which could not only be great for VR and non-VR gamers to co-op in the same game, like we've seen before from games like Keep Talking and Nobody Explodes, but it would be great for location-based setups or esports where cameras could now potentially give a much more true-to-life representation of what it's really like in VR. And it's this same tech that allows Quest to cast what you are seeing in VR onto a nearby TV or mobile phone, so others can just watch you play, or so you can record your experience and share it with the world. There's also a few other features to Oculus's Insight system, including a recallable play space and guardian boundary, meaning that when you set up your Quest at your home to play a game, then use it at another location, and then use it again at home, the Quest will remember your home setup so you don't have to recalibrate it again. And the guardian boundaries provided by Quest that stop you from banging into shit are multi-room, meaning you could set up boundaries in multiple rooms in your house on the same headset, which could allow you to develop or play a game based on the layout of your actual house. Horror fans, you immediately spring to mind for that one. In addition, John Carmack, Oculus's chief technical officer and the co-creator of Doom and Wolfenstein 3D, among other things, even mentioned that the Quest could have low latency pass-through and mixed reality functionality, as the cameras are on all the time. Though the cameras aren't exactly where your eyes are, so there would be a little offset. And in fact, programs who played Dead and Buried at Oculus Connect 5 on a Quest reported that what you see initially when you put the headset on is a white outlined version of the real world through the lenses, which a few people have compared to this clip from Aha. Then, after a few seconds, the VR game dissolves over the real world until you are completely immersed in the virtual world. And as you play, you can push a button on the touch controller to view that whitewashed real world outline. Plus, Oculus are also looking into native hand tracking for Quest, like you would see with the Leap Motion. Though, as with the mixed reality function I just described, that is unlikely to ship with Quest initially. Now let's look at some tech specs before getting into games and more unique features. The Quest has best in-class optics courtesy of the same Gen 2 Fresnel lenses as the Oculus Go, and two 1600 by 1440 OLED displays with a pentile subpixel layout, viewable through a 95 degree field of view. This means that Quest will have a higher pixel density than a Vive Pro, and even higher than the Pimax headsets at max FOV. The OLED panels that Quest uses means that blacks will look blacker than what you see from headsets using LCD panels, like the Oculus Go or most WMR headsets, which is a very good thing. The headset is locked at a 72Hz refresh rate, which is less than the Rift and Vive's 90Hz, but more than the Oculus Go's variable 60 to 70Hz refresh rate, depending on the app you are using at the time. The headset has spatial audio built into the head strap, just like an Oculus Go, which, if you haven't tried it, is fucking phenomenal actually. And as an audiophile, I don't say that lightly. It has a hardware IPD adjustment, like a Rift or Vive, meaning you can calibrate the headset to your individual eye spacing. It will have around the same battery life as the Oculus Go, which, by the way, you can see more of in this full review video here. Quest is powered by a Qualcomm 835 Snapdragon system on a chip, which is the same chip that's in a Samsung Galaxy S8, which may surprise those of you who expected a more powerful 845 for sure. So why did Oculus go with the 835 chip? And how the hell will Quest run Rift quality games on that lowly son bitch? Well, there's a handful of parts to that equation actually. One part is the lower 72Hz refresh rate. Another part reduced textures, like you can see in this side-by-side comparison shot of Dead and Buried being ported from full PC VR on Rift to the Quest headset. Then there's things like using baked in instead of dynamic lighting, reducing shadows, reduced depth on unimportant parts of a scene like Oculus did with the Go release of Henry, optimized compression algorithms, and heavy software optimization from both Oculus's correction and performance enhancing techniques and stringent developer performance optimization requirements to even get their games on the Quest store. You'd be surprised actually how many subtle PC game features can be reduced drastically or removed altogether without really impacting the game in any truly detrimental way. And if a game is good, it's never because of the graphics alone. In saying that, some games like Superhot have already been said to look identical on Quest to their PC VR counterparts. There's also Oculus's Chromatic Aberration Correction algorithm, which not only removes that rainbow color flaring you would have noticed on the edges of your vision if you use an Oculus Go, but it also gives devs extra performance headroom at no extra performance cost. In addition to all of this, Quest has a fan built into the headset which allows the 835 chip to be clocked higher than it would handle in something like a mobile phone, which means better performance. So why would Oculus choose an 835 then, instead of a more powerful 845? Well, that's likely because it wouldn't make any noticeable difference to the experience going with an 845 over an 835, but it would make a noticeable difference to the price, and increasing the price would push Quest into the enthusiast price bracket, which means sale lost, mainstream fail.
Computer says no.
Mobile chips are mobile chips, and games developed for or ported to Quest would still need to be optimized for mobile use. And although an 845 would have its advantages, releasing Quest, an HMD that is targeting the mainstream price-sensitive market, with anything other than an 835 wouldn't have made a lot of sense at this point. Which brings me to games. Quest won't use the Oculus Go or Rift library. Games and apps for Quest will be developed separately, though you can expect Rift and Go titles to be ported to Quest, as I mentioned moments ago. Quest will have 50 plus launch titles including Robo Recall, Moss, The Climb, Superhot, Dead and Buried, and Face Your Fears 2, with obvious future choices likely being games like Beat Saber, Big Screen, and Rec Room. Then there's the Quest exclusive Vader Immortal, a three-part Star Wars series courtesy of the partnership between Oculus, ILMX Lab, and Lucasfilm, where you'll be able to wield a lightsaber at Vader's castle and do some other Star Wars-y type shit. In addition to confirmed games, there's an ever-growing list of confirmed developers building experiences for Quest. And Nate Mitchell, the head of Rift at Oculus, said that Rift owners who already own games may get that game on Quest for free, depending on the developer of the game. What's unique about this is that Oculus had that cross-buy policy locked down to a select few on Rift, so devs couldn't just hand out free Oculus keys of their Steam games whenever's. But it now sounds like this stance could be relaxed and developers will be able to each decide for themselves. John Carmack also mentioned that for devs, getting your game on the Oculus Store won't be as easy as Rift or Go, which means Oculus aims to keep the standard high. Console high. And if that infuriates you personally, then you can rest assured that you are not the target market for this headset. So who is this headset for then? Quest is for existing VR owners that prioritize wireless above all else, or for newcomers to VR that don't want to buy and set up a gaming PC and who have a little extra cash to spend than $199 on an Oculus Go to get a more high-end experience. And trust me when I say I immediately know a handful of people that fit that bill already. It's a mainstream targeted device, and it's for the enthusiast too. But what it isn't is a Rift replacement. Oculus and third-party developers will still be heavily developing for Rift as their primary high-end PC VR platform, where programs want flawless tracking, more detailed textures, more constant depth, and bigger full-scale games like Hellblade, Skyrim, and Fallout 4 in VR. And Quest has been intentionally designed not to cannibalize that PC VR market segment, at least not in its entirety. But for others, improved optics and standalone 6DoF wireless VR is a much stronger sell than cranking your settings to max and crushing a ton of depth at 90 frames per second. This is also evident in the fact that you can't connect Quest to a PC and use it like a Rift, which is also no doubt due to the fact that adding PC functionality would increase the cost unnecessarily for people who don't want that feature, thus
just keeping the price down to $399 for a 64GB model, in fact, which is f***ing good for what you get. Surprisingly good, actually. And when you think about it, while that's not exactly cheap, it is a price that a lot of people would be okay with to gift the Quest as a birthday present or as a second headset to a family member or friend. I mean, how many times have you shown a non-tech orientated family member or friend VR and they've been immediately sold on it? Until they realize that they have to buy and set up a PC, then it was game over. Well, Quest bridges that gap, and that's what can make this headset such a powerful tool in the quest for mainstream adoption. I'm just going to completely ignore that pun. Quest will ship in spring 2019, though I'm going to say somewhere between March, the tail end of spring, and May, when Facebook has its F8 conference. Not only will this be by far the best wireless VR headset on the market, it also marks the end of Oculus's original Gen 1 VR plan, with Go, Quest, and Rift, comprised of PC VR, budget wireless VR, and quality wireless VR. So now we can look forward to Gen 2 VR, which I'll get into in another video. For now though, Oculus has done what no other VR company has for VR, and that is truly attempt to bring VR to the mainstream. So, will you get a Quest? Let me know in the comments below and I'll see you there. And that's it for this tutorial. You can help support this channel by grabbing exclusive rewards on Patreon, and if you like this video, then crush that like button, have your say in the comments below, and hit the XO logo to subscribe if you wanna. I'll see you in the next one. Peace!